This first video is on exponentials. So an exponential is a function that is of the form a to the power of x, where a is any number. So 2 to the power of x and 3 to the power of x are exponentials as well. So here is the graph of the exponential 2 to the power of x. And if you think about it, this graph makes sense. As x increases, it goes 2 to the power of 2, 2 to the power of 3, 2 to the power of 4. It gets bigger and it goes up like this. And then when x is negative, remember how negative powers work. It goes 2 to the power of minus 1, which is going to be a half, 2 to the power of minus 2, which is going to be a quarter, and 2 to the power of minus 3, which is going to be 1 over a. It gets smaller and smaller and it has an asymptote at y is equal to 0. Remember that no matter how negative x gets, it will never actually be equal to 0, y is equal to 0. It will just get smaller and smaller and smaller, and also it will never be negative because a power cannot be negative. And it crosses the y-axis at 1 because anything to the power of 0 when x is 0 is equal to 1. So it crosses the y-axis at 1. If we make a bigger, such as in 3 to the power of x, well, firstly, it's going to get bigger faster, obviously, as 3 to the power of 2, 3 to the power of 3 is bigger than 2 to the power of 2 and 2 to the power of 3. But it will actually get smaller faster as well. And this is because, well, 3 to the power of minus 1 is 1 over 3. 3 to the power of minus 2 is 1 over 9. And 3 to the power of minus 3 is 1 over 27. These numbers are smaller than the numbers for 2 to the power of x, so it gets smaller faster, but it will still have the same asymptote at y is equal to 0. It will just approach it faster. And again, it will cross the y-axis at 1, because anything to the power of 0 is equal to 1. There's a big difference in the graphs if a is bigger than 1 or if a is less than 1. So in 2 to the power of x, a is bigger than 1, but in a half to the power of x, a is less than 1. You can see that these graphs look a lot different, and this is because of the way powers work for fractions. You can see that when x gets bigger, it actually decreases, and this is because of the way powers work with fractions. A half squared is equal to a quarter, and a half cubed is equal to 1 over 8. You can see that these numbers are actually decreasing. And when x gets more negative, you can see that half to the power of x actually gets bigger. And again, this is because of how fractions work with their powers. A half to the power of minus 1 flips the fraction to 2. Half to the power of minus 2 flips the fraction and then squares it to 4. And then a half to the power of minus 3 flips the fraction and then cubes it to get a. So you can see that these numbers actually get bigger. And you can also see that a half to the power of x is the reflection of y is equal to 2x in the y-axis. And this is because, if you remember, if 2x is equal to f of x, 2 to the power of x is equal to f of x. If you recall back to the chapter 4 videos about transformations, if you want to reflect this in the y-axis, you do it by an inside the function reflection, where you do f of minus x, and you replace all the values of x with minus x, so this is going to be equal to 2 to the power of minus x. And we can simplify this by bringing this minus into the 2 here, so this is a minus 1 power, so then it flips the fraction to a half, and then to the power of x. You can see it's half to the power of x, and therefore it's a reflection. And once again, it crosses the y-axis at 1, because anything to the power of 0 is always equal to 1. And quickly, if the fraction gets smaller, like in a quarter to the power of x, it will get smaller faster and rise quicker for negatives, which makes sense if you plug in the values. And again, it will cross the y-axis at 1, because anything to the power of 0 is 1. Now, one feature of exponentials is if you sketch the graphs of their derivatives, they have very similar shapes. So here's 2 to the power of x and 3 to the power of x, and you can see that their derivatives have very similar shapes if you sketch them. But for 2 to the power of x, the derivative is too far across from f of x. And for 3 to the power of x, you can see that it's not far enough, the derivative, from the actual function. So there is a value between 2 and 3 for which, if you do its exponential, its derivative is the exact same graph as the exponential, and therefore the derivative itself is the exact same function as the exponential. And we call this number e, and then it's e to the power of x to get this function, where e is equal to 2.718 and then a bunch of numbers. It doesn't really matter that much. But its graph is the exact same as its derivative. It's the exact same graph as this. You can get this value of e on your calculator by pressing alpha and then pressing the times 10 to the power of x button. So therefore, from this, if y is equal to e to the power of x, then dy over dx is also equal to e to the power of x. And furthermore, if y is equal to e to the power of kx, where k is just a number, 1, 2, 3, it doesn't really matter, then dy over dx is equal to ke to the power of kx. So for example, if y was equal to e to the power of 3x, then dy over dx would be equal to, so the k comes down, so it's going to be 3e to the power of 3x. And then if there's a coefficient in front of it, so for example, if it's y is equal to 4e to the 2x, then dy over dx is going to be, and it's just the exact same thing we talked about in the differentiation video of when there's a coefficient at front, it's going to be 4 times, and then e to the power of 2x differentiated is going to be 2e to the power of 2x, so therefore this is going to be 8e to the power of 2x. As far as finding derivatives of e to the x, I'm going to end it here for this set of videos, as it comes up a lot more in year 2, and to be honest, I'd be quite surprised if they asked about it in AS. But the most important thing to take away here is for the function e to the power of x, its derivative dy over dx is the exact same function e to the power of x. They could ask you to transform exponentials. Here's an example of this. So we need to sketch the graph y is equal to 3e to the power of x. Now, as I talked about in chapter 4 in the transformations chapter, whenever you're doing a transformation, it's always good to sketch a soft graph of the untransformed graph. So this is y is equal to e to the power of x. So f of x is equal to e to the power of x. So therefore, 3e to the power of x is 3 f of x. And this is 3e to the power of x. So therefore, this is a stretch in the y direction of the graph e to the power of x. So if we do it, it's going to look something like this here. Now, the y-intercept here, because this is 1, this is going to be 3 times bigger. So this is going to be 3. And this is the final graph, where y is equal to 3e to the power of x. So here's another example. This one is a to the power of x, but obviously it's very similar to e to the x, and it's a very similar technique. So remember, sketch very softly the non-transformed graph, and you can use this as a basis. So this one, f of x is equal to 2 of x. So therefore, 2 of x plus 3 is x plus 3, f of x plus 3 of 2. X plus 3. So it's an inside the function translation in which it's being shifted to the left by 3. So remember that when it's inside the function, it has the opposite effect. So it's going to look something like this here, where it will still meet, if you continue this on, it will eventually kind of go like that as well. It will still have the asymptote at y is equal to 0. And we need to find the points of intersection with the axes. So this here is a different one this time. It's no longer 1 because it's been shifted to the left, so it's been moved. But the way we can figure this out is because this is when it's x is equal to 0. So what it's going to be is going to be when x is equal to 0. So it's going to be 2 of 0 plus 3, which is going to be 2 to the power of 3. So this is going to be 8. So the new y-intercept is going to be 8. So this is the final answer, where this is the graph of y of 2 of x plus 3. Here's another example where we need to sketch y is equal to e to the power of minus x. So if we say that f of x is equal to e to the power of x, then e to the power of minus x is going to be f of minus x. and that's e to the power of minus x. So as it's minus x, it's going to be a reflection in the y-axis, so it's going to be really simple. It's going to look something like this here, and then on this side it's going to come up like this. Again, it's going to intercept at 1 because it's the same intercept here, and this is equal to y is equal to e to the power of minus x. E to the power of minus x is a graph that comes up quite a bit, so maybe just memorize what this looks like. It's just a reflection in the y-axis, like this. So e to the power of x is really useful for modeling and can be used to model a wide range of data. So when is this? When can we use e to the power of x to model a scenario? Well, the spec words this as we can use e to the power of x as a model when the rate of change is proportional to the y value. Another way to say this, and maybe a bit easier way to say it, is this is when something gets bigger, it increases faster. And if this is true, if either of these statements are true, then e to the power of x is a good model. So the spec gives loads of examples when this is the case, but the best, in my opinion, is population growth. So this is a graph of the population of the world from the year 700 to today, and the x-axis is what year it is, and the y-axis is the number of people in the world. And for long periods of time, it's pretty flat. It's kind of increasing very slowly, but it's pretty flat. It's increasing at a slow pace. And then by the 1800s, it's starting to increase a lot faster. By the time we get up to here, it's increasing really fast. It's basically a vertical line. So the question is, why is the line so much steeper here compared to the line here? Well, if you think about it, this makes sense. At this point, the population is really low. It's well less than 1 billion people. So there's less people around, so therefore there are less babies being born, and therefore the population is increasing at a very slow rate. But up here, for example, the population is about 6 billion. It's really big. So there's loads of people around, so therefore there's loads more babies being born, and therefore the population increases at a faster rate. So the bigger the population is, the more babies being born, and the faster the population increases, the steeper the line is. And you might also be able to see, especially when you kind of zone into this region here, that this graph looks a lot like y is equal to e to the power of x. And again, this makes sense, because what was the one condition we said needed to be true to use e to the power of x as the model? The rate of change needs to be proportional to the y value. Now, the y value here is the population, and we just said that this is true. The bigger the population is, the faster the line is increasing, because there's more babies being born, so therefore the population increases faster. So therefore the rate of change is proportional to the y value. The bigger population is, the faster it increases. So again, there are loads of examples when e to the power of x is a good model, as well as population models, because there's loads of examples of this where when something gets bigger, like the population, it increases faster. And to make models more specific to each set of data, rather than just using e to the power of x, you can make it more specific by using transformations, and you can go as far as saying that y is equal to a e to the power of bx plus c, and then you can do plus d. You can add loads of transformations to it, and you can change a, b, c, and d to change the shape of the graph. Just on a quick note as well, for something like radioactive decay, which is also mentioned on the spec, we can use exponential modeling, but we use e to the power of minus x instead, where it starts big and then it decreases, and the smaller the y value gets, the less it increases, to the point where it basically becomes a flat line. There's going to be loads more on this in the final video of the chapter. I haven't included this much in this video because to do exam questions on exponential modeling, you kind of need to know about logarithms. They're asked quite a lot. So there's going to be a lot more on this in the final video of this chapter, nonlinear data and exponential modeling. I've included one example in this video, but please go to that video to get some more examples of how the exam questions will actually be worded. So here's one really quick example on exponential modeling, just to show you how the questions are formatted. And as I said, there'll be loads more questions on this in the final video of this chapter after we've talked about things like logarithms. So for part A, it wants us to find the initial population of the group of deer. Now, whenever it says initial, it means the population at the start of the model, so aka in 2015. And we know that T is the time in years after 2015, so therefore in 2015, T is going to be equal to zero, because that's when it starts. So the initial population of the group of deer is going to be 2e to the power of 0.3, and then t is going to be 0 plus 24. Therefore, it's going to be 2e to the power of 0 plus 24, and anything to the power of 0, remember, is just 1, so therefore it's going to be 2 times 1, so it's going to be 2 plus 24, so it's going to be 26. So the initial population is 26 deer. So for part B, we need to predict the population of the group of deer by 2025. So as the model starts in 2015 and T is the time in years after 2015, therefore 2025, T is going to be equal to 10. So therefore P is going to be equal to 2e 0.3 10 plus 24. And if you put that into a calculator, that's equal to 64.171, but obviously you can't have like a point of a deer, it has to be a whole number, so therefore we round this to 64. So in 2025, the model predicts it's going to be 64 deer. Now, part C is for A-level students only. You could be asked to do multiple transformations, and this is actually not that bad, because a lot of the time when we talk about modeling for e to the power of x, they only really want you to consider positive values of x, because x will usually represent a period of time, something like that, which can't be negative, and that's the case here. So why does this make it easier? Well, the reason it makes it easier is because, remember, transformations, what we normally do is do a light sketch of the untranslated graph. So this would be like this, where this is p is equal to e to the power of t, and then we're going to do all the transformations here. I'm not going to do them here, but basically what you're going to find out is, because we have our own axes and because we're not considering the negative values, basically the graph, no matter what we do, is basically just going to look like the graph that we just drew here. This is just going to be the graph of p is equal to 2e to the power of 0.3t plus 24. The only difference in which it could do is if there were negatives involved. So if this was negative, then obviously this would be below the x-axis. If this was negative here, then remember it would be a minus exponential like this instead. But as this isn't the case, we can literally just more or less sketch a graph of y is equal to e to the power of x here. And this is a perfectly valid final answer, except for one thing, and that is because the y-intercept is usually 1, but this is not going to be the case anymore because of the transformations. The y-intercept, remember, is going to be when t is equal to 0, so this is going to be 2e to the power of 0.3 times 0 plus 24, which is going to be equal to, remember that anything 0.3 times 0 is going to be 0, and anything to the power of 0 is 1, so this is going to be 2 plus 24, so this is going to be equal to 26. So the new y-intercept is going to be 26 here, and this is a perfectly valid answer, final answer. Just one thing I want to call your attention to, it says between 2015 and 2045, and the only reason it says this, it doesn't actually matter too much, the only reason it says this is so the model is showing that it's not going to go like hundreds or thousands of years into the future, because for this model, modeling a population of a group of deer, this can only go for only so many years, it can't go for like hundreds of years or something like that. So this is just an appropriate time frame.